Let's talk about Brian Robinson. Let's start with the good news first. He is out of the hospital.
It was beautiful, you know, just getting back on the field, having fun, you know, being around my coaches and team again.
This is Hog Farmer Chris from the Hog Farmers Charitable Foundation. And before you start listening to Red Zone in the Lab, check out our Amazon Smile, a simple way to support the Hog Farmers Charitable Foundation every time you shop, and it's no cost to you.
We're back! Welcome back to Red Zone in the Lab with Deuce.
Welcome to a brand new season of the Red Zone in the Lab podcast, where nothing is off the table. We will be discussing entrepreneurship, education, Black history, health, movies, family, and of course, sports. So do yourself a favor, make sure you like, subscribe, and follow on all social media platforms, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And of course, you can always visit us at redzoneinthelab.com.
Welcome back. This is Red Zone in the Lab podcast. I am Deuce, Deion Deuce Blackney. We welcome you again today. It is Thursday. It's at 6:11 p.m. and it has been a rainy week. It has been a rainy week in the D.C. area. It has been a rainy week in the Commanders fan base. It has been very drowsy. A lot of people are hanging on the edge as much as they can. Today we have Kadar in the building. He represents the Commander's heart and these Twitter spaces streets. But even Kadar is kind of close to the edge a little bit. Where are you? Kadar, man, I appreciate you for joining, bro. How you doing today?
Good, man. Thanks for having me. Happy to be here.
So before we get into some ball, Kadar, you're a Commander's fan. How long have you been? Are you a generational Commanders fan, or you just kind of pick it up along the way?
I picked it up along the way. You know, my folks, they from Somalia. So, you know, they really didn't get into football until I started watching. So I've been a Commanders fan since Santana Moss caught that touchdown in Dallas, man. You know, so
one of my favorite moments.
Since 05, man, I've been watching, and, you know, I just want to see a winning team, man. You know, like, we've had some very exciting games, you know, exciting players, even exciting seasons, but just, you know, kind of making that a consistent thing, you know, that's what we really want. So,
yeah, I see. And then we kind of chatted up before. I see you say you coach basketball. Tell the listeners, where do you coach? Because I always want to promote, you know, people that's doing positive things in the community, being a role model to the youth.
Yeah, man. I coach basketball at Sligo Middle School, and I also help out at Kennedy High School. You know, so those are the two places in Silver Spring, Montgomery County. I also teach physical education and health at Sligo Middle School. So, you know, I like giving back to the kids, you know, especially the people of color, you know, my Black and brown brothers and sisters. You know, I try to, you know, make sure that their kids are in good hands and, you know, try to really get them to see the way I see things and try to give them the experience that most of us might not have had. So, you know, trying to really make a difference and just, you know, helping others learn, but then also just be understanding of, like, you know, the environment, being woke and just, you know, having somebody to go to and, you know, somebody that, you know, is there for them. And, you know, it's good to just have a trusted adult that they can relate to. So I try to be that person.
Yeah, man, I appreciate that, man. I really do. All right, Commanders. I know I kind of teased you a little bit about the edge. Let's get that out the way first. Where are you as far as tank, throw it in a dumpster, all the way to we can make a move? We can make a run. Like, we can get better. There's optimism to get better. Where are you in it?
I mean, I'm never the one to be I'm not one to ever support tanking. Like, I don't ever think tanking is the answer, just because, I mean, at the end of the day, I feel like basketball is a sport that, like, even with the draft lottery, you know, people like to tank to go ahead and get the next big guy. But in football, you know, I think prospects are just harder to like predict. You know, it's just 53 guys and, you know, so many different position groups and guys coaching them and stuff. I think you just got to go out and win by any means necessary. And, you know, with this group, I feel like, you know, it's not going the way we hope it would go, you know, but I think, you know, we can just watch and just hope that, you know, we get as many wins as possible. But, you know, I'm tired of the 7-win seasons, man. You know, I'd rather be really good or really bad. But, you know, I just want this group to just go out and compete every Sunday and just, you know, do the best that they can and, you know, see where that goes.
What has been the biggest disappointment so far?
I think just not putting the pieces together. I think, you know, with some of the players that we've let go, and the guys that we've brought in to replace them, I feel like, you know, just personnel-wise, I feel like we're just not putting our players in the best position to succeed. Like, I think if we go ahead and make these personnel moves, you know, we should be going ahead and, like, improving on, you know, years in the, you know, Ron Rivera, Scott Turner, Jack Del Rio, like, you know, coaching era. And I feel like, you know, it feels like, you know, it's a work in progress, but in a way it's almost like we're regressing. We're getting worse.
Yeah.
You know? And I think that's what's the most disappointing thing.
When it comes to this upcoming game against the Titans, what's your overall outlook before we get into, you know, a little more detailed and specifics, but what's your overall outlook for this game and, you know, the subsequent games behind it?
I mean, at the end of the day, you know, they got to take it 1 week at a time. Just go 1-0, you know, that's all you can really do. And I think that this Titans game that they got coming up is a very winnable game. They're going against a Tennessee team that's 2-2, could be 3-1, but, you know, they have their weaknesses and they got a lot going on too. I think we match up really well with them and it's a home game. So I think we just got to go 1-0 this week and, you know, just handle our business and go from there.
All right, Kadar, what do you think the importance of Brian Robinson Jr. is if he is activated and he plays? Are we putting too much on him, or do you think this is just what he's made for, especially being from Alabama?
I think Brian Robinson, you know, to quote Scott McLuhan, you know, that was a GM that we had back, you know, a few years ago,
the football player.
I think, you know, Brian Robinson, he's built for this. Like, I really do think that. Now, I think the Washington Commanders and, you know, just football fans, should you pump the brakes just a little bit, just understand that, like, this is a man that got shot, you know, and it's bigger than football. You know, his whole life, he's got ahead of him, right? So the fact that he's able to walk, he's healthy, be with his family, you know, that's real encouraging. And that's, you know, the most important thing at the end of the day. And on top of that, to play the game that he loves, I think, you know, it's just an added bonus. So Brian Robinson, you know, he's going to come out and he's going to be him and he's going to do what he, you know, wants to do. But at the end of the day, we got to ease him back. We got to, you know, not expect too much from him, you know. And if we play our cards like how we did in the preseason and the offseason where Brian Robinson came in and competed and he earned his right to, you know, play, I think, you know, he's got nothing to prove to nobody, but I think we just got to be, you know, patient with him and just not overload him with what he can't do. You know, I think, you know, being out of football for a month and, you know, being week 5 in the regular season, that's a real adjustment. He hasn't played since week 1 in the preseason. I think Brian Robinson helps Antonio Gibson. I think he helps JD McKissick. He helps the offense. And I think that's the biggest thing.
The calendar says that summer is ending soon, but we're still outside. So when it's time to hop in your ride, make sure you book the best mobile detailing service in the DMV, Miles Detailing. Call 240-273-4018 or contact on Instagram at Miles Detailing to book your service today. Mention Red Zone in the Lab podcast for 10% off detail services only. Ride in style with Miles Detailing, that is.
Come back to Red Zone. deuce.
All right, give me some keys to winning, some three keys to winning this game.
I think first, we got to start fast. We got to be able to win first quarter. You know, I'm not even going to go first half. I think we got to win the first quarter. Yeah, Tennessee, they, you know, they've scored on their opening drive in every game this year. So I think trying to just start out fast, you know, I'm not even going to go out and say, go ahead and stop Tennessee from scoring. I mean, because, you know, our defense, you know, we've been up and down, but I think just matching Tennessee in the first quarter, we can't have another game like Dallas, like Philadelphia, where the team that we're going against just starts out fast and then we're coming back from behind. You know, I think we should apply pressure, especially being the home team, get momentum early and have us, you know, applying pressure. So Tennessee feels that and they're the ones coming back from behind early, you know, so.
Yeah, I agree. I think we need to, like the first week, we scored on the first couple drives and we was on our way to scoring a third one before the Samuels fumble. What's another key, like on defense? What does the defense have to do in order for us to win this game?
I think our pass rush has to get home. You know, I think our pass rush has to get home. We got to put Tennessee in third and long situations. I mean, just because Tennessee is a team that we know they're going to run the football. You know, they have King Henry in the backfield. King Henry is one of the best running backs. I think he's the best running back in the NFL. Okay. If you ask me, but just from a talent perspective, but you know, King Henry, we go ahead and we stop him, you know, we put Tennessee, you know, in third and long, you know, because of passing situation, they don't really have a receiver that really frightens me. Like, mm-hmm. You know, Christian Kirk for Jacksonville was a guy that's got paid in the offseason. You know, Jacksonville, you know, coveted him. You know, we went against Amon-Ra St. Brown, Devontae Smith, C.D. Lamb, you know, these are all receivers that have done really well against us. Tennessee, I mean, their top target, in my eyes, is, you know, Robert Woods or maybe even Chigakonkwo, who went to Maryland, you know, go Terps. So, I mean, there's not really a premier guy on the outside that really strikes fear in our defense. With that being said, we can't have anybody beat us either, you know what I'm saying, even though they, you know, don't strike any fear. I think if we can force Ryan Tannehill – in third and long situations, I think, you know, that's going to be very favorable for our defense. And then our offense, you know, getting that field position battle, you know. So I think having shorter fields and, you know, giving our offense, you know, less room to really worry about, you know, moving down the field, you know, I think that's going to give us more points and just a greater opportunity to win.
Yeah, I'm thinking when it comes to premier receivers, and we faced a lot, and I don't think they do. Of course, their first-round pick, Treylon Burks, won't be there. Robert Woods will. He's a guy that can beat you deep. But just like last week with Brown, with the Cowboys, like even those guys are not premier, they're NFL wide receivers, and they're capable of making big plays. And that's kind of been our Achilles heel is those big plays. Because one thing we can't do, we can't separate the big plays at the end of the day, right? We have to combine them. But if you want to do it for an exercise and separate them, then our defense, we have a very good defense, possibly top 10. But the big plays obviously matters, even though we didn't have as much as we had.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I think, you know, for sure, big plays, we can't allow that. You know, I don't really see Tennessee as a team that's going to, you know, get big pass plays. But, you know, you never know because our defense got to prove it. They got to show us that they can stop big plays. You know, and especially in the run game, I think, you know, Derrick Henry is capable of popping a big play anytime. So, you know, just controlling the line of scrimmage the best that we can, you know, getting to the quarterback when they do throw, because they will throw. You know, they're one of the worst passing offenses in the league. They're actually beneath us and, you know, many other teams. They're like 27, I think. So, you know, just making sure that we stay consistent with that, you know, keeping them, you know, behind the chains, you know, not letting them beat us deep, you know, DBs, you know, staying on their keys, you know, not making, you know, mistakes, communicating, I think will be good.
What are some key matchups for this weekend's game?
The Tennessee edge versus our offensive line. So, you know, they got Bud Dupree. And they got Rashad Weaver, who actually leads the team in sacks. He's got 4 sacks. I'm looking at the edge and seeing if we can you know, win that battle. You know, we got a backup right tackle coming in. Cornelius Lucas is going to start over Sam Cosmi. I'd like to see, you know, Lucas and Leno hold up, you know, against the edge. I think our interior line against Jeffrey Simmons is going to be another one. You know,
yeah,
just that front seven overall, I think, versus our offensive line is going to be huge. And then I think, you know, kind of the same thing, you know, the other way. I think Derrick Henry versus our front seven is going to be another key matchup. I think this game really is going to be a close game. I think there's going to be a lot of rushing attempts between both teams. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, it's going to be front seven versus front seven, you know.
But where is a strength that we have that we can really exploit the Tennessee Titans?
I think, I mean, to be honest with you, our biggest strength is wide receiver. But, you know, I think the Tennessee Titans, you know, their secondary is very well coached. And, you know, I don't know if we can really exploit that. Mm-hmm. I think we just got to win, you know, our downs, like, you know, stay in third and short on offense, you know, move the chains, get first downs, you know, get some targets to Terry McLaurin. You know, I know Kevin Byard is back there deep and he's, you know, another premier player, you know, in the defensive backfield. You know, I don't think many plays are going to get by him, especially over the middle. I think, you know, he keeps the ball in front of him. You know, I don't think we're going to get any, you know, big plays over the top, but I think, you know, underneath, you know, Curtis Samuel, if he's in the slot, you know, potentially JD McKissic, Antonio Gibson, I think, you know, that middle of the field, I think, is a place that we might have some success.
Yeah, I'm hoping that can be ish. I hope we can get Terry the ball. And we've heard that a lot. Where are you with the importance of getting Terry the ball early and often, regardless of how he gets the ball?
I think, you know, it's a fine line. You know, I don't want Carson Wentz to be like, you know, Terry down there somewhere. Like, you know, I think Terry McLaurin should be the first read on almost every play. You know, there's no reason for Carson not to look Terry's way, because Terry is a great wide receiver in this league and he's open a lot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, but as far as all of our wide receivers go, you know, Curtis Samuel, Jahan Dotson, like, we have a lot of talent in the room, but there's not a guy at that skill, at that position group, that is more like Terry's great at contested catches. Like, you throw it to Terry's way, he's going to fight for the football. You know, it's going to be something good that happens if you look for Terry McLaurin. I think, you know, if the first read isn't there and Terry's covered, you know, which, you know, it happens from time to time, but it's not all the time. You know, go ahead, move on to your second, your third read. You got a lot of options. You know, you got a lot of talent at wide receiver and tight end, but Terry should be your best receiver, should be looked and targeted way more than we've been targeted. And a part of that is because of the offensive line, but I think there's got to be more accountability and more effort from Carson Wentz to, you know, look Terry's way. And I guess, you know, that might come with more comfort in the offense, but, you know, Terry's out there, find him and get him the football.
All right, let's go offense. Who is your spotlight player for this week that you believe is going to have a big game?
I like Curtis Samuel. I think Curtis Samuel is going to be a player underneath that's going to kill the Titans, you know, if we let him. I think Terry McLaurin, you know, he's going to draw a lot of attention. And, you know, that's another reason, you know, Terry McLaurin doesn't get as many targets. But with Jahan Dotson out, I think even more so, Terry's going to get a lot of attention. I look for Curtis Samuel to, you know, get some targets and lead us in targets again.
Okay. What about the defensive side of the ball?
Defensive side of the ball, I'm looking for Kendall Fuller to, you know, have a bounce back game. Like, you know, he's kind of been under the spotlight. You know, he's gone against some, you know, really good, even, you know, some not so popular wide receivers, but these are all NFL receivers, like you pointed out to, right? I think this has got to be a game where Kendall Fuller, you know, shows people that, you know, he's an NFL corner. He is a captain on our defense. And, you know, him just covering, keeping the ball in front of him, you know, maybe even potentially getting a turnover. I think, you know, that would really bode well for him.
And like 45 seconds left, Kadari, give me your overall thought about where this team has come from, where this team is, and where you hope this team will go.
I think this team really has shown that they can fight. You know, I think this Ron Rivera era, like, this team doesn't go away, especially when we had Taylor Heinicke last couple, you know, last year, and then, you know, the year before at the end. You know, they show a lot of resilience. Right now, we're 1-3, you know, back against the wall. You know, some people are saying code red. I'd like to see that fight continue. Go 1-0 this week, you know, forget all the outside noise, put everything behind you, and just go out and win a football game. Where this team is at right now, I think that's what they got to focus on, just going 1-0 each week. And where this team can go, I just hope that they can really, you know, continue to get healthy, show improvement defensively. You know, just with Jack Del Rio, him being his third year, we got a lot of, you know, similar players that we've had in, you know, previous years. I think they've got to put it together. And I think that group has gotten better over the course of the season. I'd like to see the offense, you know, show that they're consistency. They're more consistent, you know, going forward. But I would really like to see this team put together a complete game, you know, good offense, stuff, defense, special teams.
Good stuff, Kadari. Score prediction.
I like Washington 23-20.
Okay. I'm 24-23 Washington. So I thought you was kind of going with exactly where I was going at, but it's close. Kadari, man, I appreciate you for joining. I really appreciate you for taking the time. Like, I know your time is very valuable. And of course, you're about to get ready for your basketball players and your youth and your community work. So, man, yeah, I really do appreciate it. I know, you know, your time is valuable and you spending it some with us. I really appreciate it.
Yes, sir, man. Appreciate you for having me.
You can drop your handle or any, you know, where people can follow you on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, whatever you have.
Yeah, I'm at K Muzzy on Twitter, KMUZZY underscore, if you want to follow me. So I'm in the Commander spaces a lot, you know, Twitter sports spaces, sports after dark, sports and coffee, facts and stats.
Kadari in there representing big, man. He be taking all that heat, boy. How you doing, man? You taking that heat?
Got to, man. Just be real. That's all you can do. And, you know, just be proud of your team. Don't switch up, you know.
That's right.
Talk your stuff, but, you know, be smart. And, you know, go Commander. Stick with your team.
That's right, man. We appreciate all of you out there. Again, this is Red Zone the Lab Podcast. We thank you all for listening. We thank you for watching. Be safe out there. One beat. One sound, one heart, one love.
Thank you for listening to Red Zone in the Lab Podcast. Please follow us on Facebook and Instagram. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at Red Zone in the Lab. And you can download our podcast at Spotify, iTunes, and Podbean. And please visit our website at redzoneinthelab.com. Thank you.